Berserker Blue Death by Fred Saberhagen. Chapter 1. The bright orange lights of the alarm began to flash, as if in deliberate synchronism with the first notes of live wedding music coming from the electronic organ. The lights of the alarm were positioned all around the top of the circular wall, about 3 meters high, that rimmed the huge domed room, and they extended up against the lower portion of the huge clear dome itself, making it impossible that they should not be seen. The orange lights were eerily beautiful against the driving, rolling whiteness, shot through with distant pastel colors that seemed to fill all space outside the dome. In synchronism with the first flash of the lights, the audio component of the alarm came blasting with almost deafening loudness through the rich sounds of the wedding processional. At the impact, the organ music trailed and shuddered away to nothing, while the piercing blatting of the alarm itself kept on and on. Niles Domingo swore under his breath, invoking gods and creatures stranger than the gods. Reflexively, he called on beings he did not believe in, that at most were no more than half believed in, even by the people of the farthest and most isolated colonies. He had a sense of last night's bad dream intruding into reality. At the moment the alarms came on, Domingo was standing with his daughter at one end of the long aisle that passed diametrically under the center of the domed assembly hall. Mamio's hand first tightened on her father's arm, then slipped away, as if she were determined to leave him as free as possible of personal distraction. Domingo turned to look into his daughter's dark brown eyes, at her lovely face framed in the pure white of unfamiliar ceremonial lace. She was gazing back at him trustfully. Her expression said that her father was still her first source of guidance on any problem, on how to deal with a wedding or an attack alarm, or, as now, both at the same time. At least the flashing lights around the wall were not bright red, nor was the audio alarm of the shrieking kind that would have proclaimed the imminence of a berserker attack upon the colony of Shubra. Instead, the signal was the comparatively less terrible one of a simple orange alert. Still, there was no choice about responding to it, and no option for even the smallest delay in doing so. No option. Yet, for a long moment in the huge room, no one had moved. Domingo and his daughter were standing together in the rear of the biggest indoor space available for human gatherings on the colonized planetoid called Shubra, satellite of a sun that had never been seen from Earth. 30 meters away from where father and daughter stood, at the front end of the long aisle, the clergy and the witnesses were waiting. And of course the groom was up there too, Gujar Sidoruk, looking even bigger and bulkier than ever in his formal citizen's robes. Gujar was gazing back at his bride-to-be and at her father as if he, independent young man that he was, were also waiting to be told what had to happen next. The first moment of the alarm seemed to be protracted endlessly. It was as if the warning had already sounded for a long time, but these people, having committed themselves to a wedding, could not quite make up their minds to respond to it. Before the long moment was over, most of the roomful of people were looking at Niles Domingo, too. 9/10 of the population of the colonized planetoid, some 200 people, were assembled in this hall today. With them were 20 or 30 visiting neighbors, people from other small inhabited rocks within the Milkpail Nebula. A handful of the neighbors lived virtually next door, on Shubra's unnamed moon, but the others had traveled up to a full day to get here, astrogating their way 500 million kilometers through nebular space. Occupying almost as much floor space in the huge room as the people did was a small forest of plant life, some of the forest's individual components towering over the humans' heads. The permanent flora of the chamber, imported from Earth and elsewhere, had been augmented for today's occasion by extra greenery and 1 million flowers joyously freighted in from another colony, Yerkala. On Shubra, as on most of the other small colonized rocks that revolved around certain suns within the Milkpail Nebula, outdoor ceremonies were rarely practical. The great domed room brought the assembly as close to the out-of-doors as was feasible. Overhead, a clear hemisphere of force and crystal held back the whiteness and the sunset clouds of the long winter night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.